Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Today I want to talk about how some of the literature I've been reading lately intersects very explicitly with ideas about history. One of my favorite statements about the place of history in our lives is a quote from William Faulkner, "The past isn't dead, it isn't even past." The resonance of the past shapes how we understand our present and how we imagine crafting our futures. As we learn as we interact with other people in our societies, we don't always seem to feel we've had the same pasts at all. That particular issue has been absolutely in the foreground recently, perhaps especially in the United States, as we try to talk about the issue of removing statues erected to honor Confederate leaders, or renaming buildings named after people now understood, even by many whites, as racist, etc. Faulkner might have been thinking about his culture's past in a different way, but the emotion he's trying to capture in that quotation feels universal. One of the books I've been reading lately is The Office of Historical Corrections by Danielle Evans, an extraordinary collection of stories considering the impact of injustice based on race and gender oppression, as well as the shifting meanings of history. I had the honor of reviewing it for the online journal Open Letters Review, and I'll leave that link below. This is my first review of fiction, which personally I find much harder to formally evaluate and write about than I do nonfiction. The fact that a couple of Evan's characters are historians might have made it easier. Cecilia, a non-historian character in one of Evan's stories, has a tattoo with that quotation from William Faulkner. The author drops this line casually. Her character belonged to a college literary society where she and her fellow students came up with the brilliant idea of tattooing ourselves with quotations from our favorite authors. Cecilia's chosen line is really the backbone for Evan's entire book. Just as Faulkner did, Evans tries to make sense of how history has shaped her characters. The past that matters most to them is both collective and personal. The characters grow up in a world shaped by America's long history of racism and sexism. But many are also living with personal grief, often the specific grief of a young woman losing her mother to cancer. Their pasts echo through their presence, as the characters come to understand both the importance of long-term friendships and the complicated movements toward forgiveness and redemption. Despite the seriousness of those themes, Danielle Evans writes with a great deal of wit and stylishness. Her short stories feel really expansive despite their few pages, often taking readers through a series of shocking revelations and major plot twists, inserted in unexpected places, seemingly buried in the middle of a sentence, in the middle of a paragraph about something else. These shifts can leave readers gasping as they race to keep up with the prose. The volume's concluding novella has a slower and more thoughtful pace, as well as a more conventional narrative structure, but it's equally stunning. One of my favorite short stories in this knockout collection is Boys Go to Jupiter. Claire's summer boyfriend, Jackson, hands her a bikini, three triangles and some string, with Confederate flag imagery of the stars and bars marking her private parts, named by the narrator with language that might get me in trouble on YouTube, and she agrees to wear it. Although neither bikinis nor Confederate flags are, quote, Claire's thing, she doesn't really question it and puts on the bathing suit to please Jackson, and to annoy her, quote, almost stepmother, who thinks it makes her look like white trash. At the end of the summer, Jackson posts a photograph of Claire wearing the bikini on social media. As she flies back to college, a black girl from her dorm sees the photograph and responds with discomfort. Soon, Claire's inbox is filled with texts ranging from hostile to bewildered. Rather than apologizing, she responds with defiance. Quote, Claire is surprised by the level of interest, then annoyed by it, writes the author. She distrusts collective anger. Claire's anger has always been her own. And then, at a moment when readers find Claire to be obnoxious and perhaps unredeemable, Evans gradually explains Claire's history. When she was in secondary school, her best friend was a black girl. The two girls' mothers went through treatment for cancer at the same time, and only one died. The complex fallout of that death, and really you should read that complexity for yourself, is a history that haunts Claire. Although we're never asked to fully sympathize with Claire, Evans helps readers begin to understand her, no matter how unsettling we might find her behavior. Evan's story makes me think a lot about the Flannery O'Connor story I narrated on this channel on Monday. Everything That Rises Must Converge tells us about a white, southern, recent college grad, Julian, and the mother he lives with. The story is set soon after the integration of public buses in their southern community during the early civil rights movement. At least if you had an old-school white southern grandmother or neighbor, you'll probably recognize his mother, and perhaps find her a bit charming, but also racist and embarrassing. Julian, on the other hand, thinks of himself as progressive, as unprejudiced. The reader sees better, sees that his racism is different from his mother's, but absolutely not absent. And unlike his mother, Julian does not face the world with love or basic human kindness, even if that kindness is horribly distorted by racist assumptions, as it is in his mother's case. I won't go into much direct plot comparison between Danielle Evans' story and Flannery O'Connor's story, but suffice it to say that the number of parallels is a little startling. O'Connor has a lightning moment where Grace enters the story. This is not a spoiler in any way, since I think it's probably true of every single thing she wrote. For Evans' characters, that moment of grace is far less clear and far more complicated. The final story in Evans' collection is the novella that lends the book its title. Cassie Jacobs, a former history professor, works in a federal office building in Washington, D.C. as an investigator for the Institute of Public History. Designed to be a new public works project for the intellectual class, the Institute hired historians across the nation to correct inaccuracies on placards at monuments and museums and even souvenir shops. Critics called the IPH everything from the Big Brother Institute to the Bureau of Whitewashing. The nickname that stuck? The Office of Historical Corrections. After the Institute's director asked Cassie to fix their Genevieve problem, she packs her bags for Wisconsin to investigate a complaint against her former colleague. Genevieve's, quote, most persistent and controversial grievance was the passive voice atrocity. Wherever there was a memorial, she wanted to name not just the dead, but the killers, explains the author. She thought the insistence on victims without wrongdoers was at the base of the whole American problem, the lie that supported all the others. In an almost exclusively white town northwest of Milwaukee, Genevieve had replaced a plaque memorializing a black man burned to death in an arson attack so she could name his attackers. A descendant of one of the arsonists questioned the accuracy of the plaque and requested a clarification from the IPH. Key to the story is that Cassie and Genevieve were more than colleagues. The two women had been friends and rivals since they were young, when they were among the only black students at a predominantly white prep school in Washington, D.C. Although they attended different colleges, they found themselves together again in graduate school and then at the IPH. Cassie's assignment to rein in Genevieve sets off a mystery with revelations that cut to the heart of the nation's racial imagination. By facing the truth of a past filled with desperate attempts for liberation, as well as saturated with their own personal history of division and sadness, Claire and Genevieve are able to bring about a kind of resolution, uneven reconciliation. As I finished this novel, I kept thinking about Nella Larsen's novella, Passing, written during the Harlem Renaissance. There's something very similar about the relationship between Cassie and Genevieve and the tense relationship between the two protagonists in Larsen's book. The issue of racial passing is key in both Larsen's work and the Office of Historical Corrections, but it occurs in very different situations and has different fallouts, shall we say. As I was thinking about the connections between Evans and Larsen, I found out about a book club discussion put together by T Magazine, a part of the New York Times. I watched the discussion live on Tuesday evening and am thrilled to say that the video recording is available on YouTube now. I'll leave a link to it in the show notes. While I would really love to hear Danielle Evans talk about Larsen's story and hear if she was consciously inspired by it as she wrote her own story, instead, T Magazine invited the contemporary novelist Britt Bennett, author of The Vanishing Half, a book which also considers similar questions. I highly recommend the discussion, which was insightful and really compelling. The other book I want to mention, and I'm going to keep this much shorter, is a book of poems, The Historians by Eavan Boland. Boland, who finished this collection shortly before her death and never got to see it in print, had a long career as a poet, and is especially known for writing about the experiences of women in Ireland. Like Faulkner, and like Evans, Boland is fascinated by the way the past resonates in the present. Let me make a small detour for a moment, although I often use the word history to mean the same thing I mean by the past. That usage is, of course, not quite accurate. What I used to teach my undergraduates was that the past referred to what actually happened. History is what we have access to, often shaped by who left records, or who is doing the investigation, or who is telling the story. And historiography is what we do when we build a history of histories, when we look at the way lots of different people have tried to understand the past by creating different histories, interpretations which often speak to each other. Boland is interested in exactly this kind of distinction between history and the past. Frustrated by the ways that people's experiences in the past, especially women's personal experiences of the past, get erased from the mainstream narrative, she wants to bring those voices forward and allow them to expand our understanding of the past. As she writes, "Say the word history. I see your mother, mine. Their hands are full of words." Her poems are filled with images of women's daily lives, from laundry and kitchens to the detritus of a house full of children. Boland is interested in the way the past was actually lived, the way it's remembered, and the way in which it continues to live within us, the stories which define us, even if they aren't highlighted in the official record. I want to call your attention to a few video recordings available for free online, recordings I will link to down in the show notes. I had initially considered reading one of the poems in the volume, but what you will hear in these videos brings far more to the poems than I ever could. One video is the phenomenal socially distanced launch party for Boland's The Historians. The beginning of the discussion includes a section with Michael Schmidt, author of the mammoth book, the novel, a biography, which I'll be reading throughout the year. Schmidt was her editor for many years. The celebration also includes readings by several folks, including Colm Toibin and Boland's youngest daughter. There's also a wonderful tribute video to Boland that includes many other readers, including two poets I especially love and who I had the opportunity to get to know many years ago, Marie Howe, with her beautiful voice, and Kevin Young, a spectacular poet who often reflects Boland's focus on the immediacy of the past in his poems. And finally, I'll include a link to Eavan Boland reading her poem, Quarantine. Well, that's it for today. Thank you for joining me today here on Hannah's Books. See you soon.